Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Father, as we tend to the business of those we serve, Father, we just ask for your divine guidance. Father, I do pray for the poor. Lord, we just pray that you'll bless our troops and bring them home safely. And we thank you for each one of them. They're defending the freedom of this great country. These things I do pray in your name. Amen. Please stand for our pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Next we have on the agenda public speakers, Mr. Tony Cox.
Recently, in watching a documentary, I discovered that some religions, if you pray with them, you are one of them. And I've had people that's tried to get me to pray with them before and not do it. I don't pray with people. I go to the side. I respect their right to pray, but up in the Northeast, in one of them states up there, two firemen got to the scene of a fire, and there was a kid that was dying. They were the first responders there, the way it sounded. They put the kid in the fire truck and went to the hospital, saved the life. But the county government or the fire department fired them. They said that there was a issue about safety because of being seat belted in, and what if, but what if didn't happen. But I stand behind those guys, and everybody should get behind them. There's a deal out there on Facebook about it. This deal with me and the county referencing what was done back in 2007, over and over and over again, I have said, let's fix it. Two SBI agents told me that sometimes in the United States of America, that justice can only be served through monetary means. And as we look around, we find that that is actually true. When I hear people tell me sometimes that somebody, a lawyer, is an officer of the court, and in some of these lawyers, I know what they've done, and that shows part of why our judicial system is in the shape it's in. If you take somebody to jail and you put them in prison or whatever, you convict them of a felony, and then you say when you come out of prison that you can't do better, something is wrong with the thinking of that. Judges, they over and over and over, they'll tell people, good luck, good luck, good luck, and people don't realize it until afterwards what's coming down the pike. The people's thinking about a lot of things in this country need to be looked at. And there are people in positions of power that get things done that they shouldn't be done. Bad will always come out, always. Over the last 8 years or so, when it comes to me, we can look back at all the retaliations.
Thank you, Mr. Cuff.
But I still stand firm, and I still love y'all.
Thank you, Mr. Cuff. Next, we have Mr. Rick Bowman.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
You probably remember me being here before. I live on Altamaha Racetrack Road, right across from the A Speedway, and we had some noise issues, which I was here about previously. We've actually were recommended by you guys to go to the planning board, which we did, and then we were told by the planning board to try to mediate with the managers, which we met with the managers three times last year, and we're still having problems. We had agreements that were broken. There's practices every day of the week. There was a BMW drifting club that was there on Saturday night and Sunday morning. I didn't even know what drifting was until I found out there's a bunch of cars out there just spinning around burning tires. It sounds like a bunch of race cars running around out there. But that was all Sunday morning into Sunday afternoon. They're working on the go track Sunday mornings and afternoons several times this year, and they were doing that last year. Go-kart events, participants stay overnight before the race, and they start generators at 8 a.m., and then the event lasts until about 10 p.m., so you got about 14 to 15 hours constant on that on a Saturday. And the current noise ordinance and industrial use ordinance gives Ace Speedway more rights than any business in Alamance County. Any event is okay with current wording of any scheduled event. That's what it says, any scheduled event, and that's what they say when the sheriff's department's called out there. There's no restrictions on the expansion of the go-kart facility. They're currently expanding it, moving the lights around. They're going to have the lights facing out, and it's right in our front yards, the people who live right across from it. Currently, the sheriff's department, their hands are tied. They can't do anything when called. There's no time limit, no limit on types of events out there. All they have to do is say it's a scheduled event, and it's okay. Right now, we're on the fourth manager in a little over a year, and the current owner, Abraham Wodlowski, I'm probably slaughtering that name, but he says it was a mistake to buy the track, and he owns 16 businesses, so it's not a primary concern of his. There's a current real estate listing on the internet where it says that the track can be used for a circus, county fair, concerts, or any other private events. He's trying to sell a half interest in it for about $1 million. So that's the mindset we're dealing with. So we need your help to protect our community's rights to some peace and quiet, at least at certain times during the week. Also to protect us against certain types of events at the track. And we have a petition signed by 78 residents who live within a close proximity to the track that agree with what we're saying. And those people signed that within the last month or two. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Comments from commissioners?
Yes, I understand that the noise ordinance is going to be revisited at the next planning board.
Right.
Eddie, you're on that.
We are. We're going to look at that, and Libby's got some potential proposals on that, I think. One thing just caught my attention. I didn't realize they were camping there. I don't think that was part of the original racetrack plan to have a campground also on the site. But
they advertised for Halloween last year that they could bring kids and have an overnight Halloween event there before the race on Friday. Friday night's when they stayed, and they had the go-kart race the next day.
Are they permitted?
Libby could probably answer that. You want to address that question there, Libby?
According to the heavy industrial use ordinance, they were in place prior to the ordinance, and anything controlled by that or any property owned by them can be used for the use of the racetrack.
So right, currently we're in the process, your office, of researching what can be done, and there'll be some recommendations in the future.
Well, we can look at that.
Yeah, right.
We're looking at the noise ordinance specifically at this moment.
Again, are they permitted?
Can you answer that? Why? I know you've had some dealings.
They were in existence before.
Because of being grandfathered.
So what are the options in terms of any changes, the fact it's a pre-existing business?
Well, you can put reasonable time limits on businesses like that.
I think that there needs to be a compromise. I mean, the racetrack was there when a lot of folks moved there, but when it expanded outside what you thought it was, then that changed the whole parameter of what was going on and the times. Or I wouldn't appreciate getting up on Sunday morning at 6 o'clock hearing generators cranking up for the race Sunday afternoon or whatever.
When I moved there about 5.5 years ago, I asked several, and that was a concern, obviously, the racetrack's right there. So I asked several of the residents what was going on, and they said you'll have a practice one time a week and then the race on Friday night. And the go-kart track was closed at the time. It was grown up, so I didn't really think that was a concern. But since then, there's just been activity, practices every day. We've had concerts, we have rodeos, tractor pulls, mud bogs. I mean, one Saturday there was cars practicing over there, go-kart was in all day, and a mud bog going on at the same time, all day long.
I guess my question, Libby, is the word scheduling. So we decide we all want to go out there and run around the track today. Is that a scheduled event, or is that just an event?
It depends. There is no specific definition in the ordinance currently.
Right. So, I mean, yes, if people know what to expect, I think it makes your life better to plan, too. I mean, everybody
has that. Well, I know it's frustrating for the sheriff's department when, mm-hmm. you know, they get phone calls and they come out there and they say, what's the scheduled event? Well, as soon as they say that,
I think that's probably one of the key words that they're working off of, is scheduled event. Anything that's happening today is scheduled.
Cannot the commissioners require or pass an ordinance that they have to submit a schedule beginning every year? That way we'll be able to remedy that problem.
Is that within our...
Well, the more you limit the use of piece of property, the more it's like a taking. So it's a balance.
Yeah.
I've been a problem with that in the past. So we'll rely on staff to take a look at it and report back to us. We're thinking.
I think that's a good idea, Sheriff. We can figure how to do that legally and let the homeowners know when to plan on sleeping and when not to sleep. So.
There's also been a lot of unsanctioned fights out there, including a big brawl with the sheriff's department, which I thought was out there.
But Judge, you know how to shut a place down when you have a problem like that, don't you?
I certainly do.
There's also been a couple of issues where there were young girls, statutory rapes from out there that I've read in the paper.
Thank you. Any further comments from commissioners?
Mr. Chairman, if the board so pleases, we can have an update from the results of the planning board meeting at our next meeting as a regular agenda item. If
please that's do.
When is that next meeting?
Thursday.
This Thursday?
Thursday at 7.
At 7 o'clock.
Can you be there or Ben? 1, 5?
Sounds good. Thank you. Any further comments from commissioners? All right. Next, we have the approval of the agenda. Do I have a motion for approval of our agenda for today?
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Consent agenda. I have Vice Chair Boswell has asked to pull item 6B, approval to apply for Impact Alamance Grant, Recreation and Parks Department. Any other items that commissioners would like to see pulled from the consent agenda? Hearing none, I'll accept a motion for acceptance of the consent agenda as amended.
So moved.
Second. I have a motion second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. Item B, 6B.
Brian, can you address that? I know you didn't wear your suit today, but I caught you off guard, didn't I? Huh? Anyhow, I think it's just something that's very important for our community to realize that outside people are concerned and trying to help out and do everything. I know they also helped at Eli Whitney with putting some money. So this is money that Impact Alamance has put towards. Tell us about it.
Yeah, Impact Alamance, which is a branch of the hospital or a project set up by the hospital, they've made a tremendous impact in the past year or two on our community by doing projects like this, by helping us build infrastructure projects for families and to get people more active. This project is one example of that. It's a partnership grant with the City of Graham and Alamance County. It's to build a trailhead and to expand a section of the Harbor Trail right here in Graham. So that's a great opportunity for us. They're giving us $25,000 to help do that, or we're requesting $25,000. We'll see what happens. But they have recently given us money to replace the playground at Eli Whitney. We were able to put with some county funds, and they got some other projects in the works with them. So they've been a great partner for us, and not just us, but really the whole community, to find ways to get kids and families more active and to make sure the limiting factor in their activity isn't that they don't have anywhere to go.
That's good. Well, I appreciate you doing that, Brian. I know being on the parks, we have a lot going on. You guys have your hands full over the next year at Cedar Rock and this and possible other things that we've talked about. And I think it's exciting to see the outside community recognizing the value of our parks and our river. And
we've gotten so much positive feedback at these community listening sessions for the strategic plan that I know you've been to a lot of them. And it's been gratifying for us to hear people appreciate the work that we're doing.
Yeah. All right, thank you. With that being said, do I have a motion for approval of the application for the grant for Impact Alamance for the Recreation and Parks Department?
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
I might add that Impact Alamance just released their report to the community Thursday evening, and there was a big article about it in the paper and everything that they've done in 2015, I guess, or this past year.
Yeah.
It's very impressive.
It's just very good. I'm excited.
Yeah. Thank you. Moving on to presentation of other business, item 7-1, tax lien advertisement, Jeremy Akins. Thank you, Brian. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Good morning, Commissioner.
Morning, sir.
Good
morning.
Thank you for having me here today. Always to talk about taxes. Each year I bring before you a report of the current delinquency and of the upcoming advertisement. This year I have a definitely a good report. Now, as of January 31st, 2016, which is when we normally benchmark delinquency, the amount of unpaid taxes was $4,678,456.65. As of this morning, it was only $2,685,316.13. We have, as of this morning, a 96.36% collection rate.
Wow.
There have been years in the past, before my administration, that was the whole year's rate. And that's where we're at here at the beginning of March. So definitely doing well. We're 10 days ahead of the same benchmark from last year, and last year was ahead from the year before that. So as the delinquency is concerned, our collections are up. Definitely the team is working very hard to bring in that revenue, so I think we're doing well. Obviously, we do have unpaid accounts, and traditionally the third Thursday of March, we put advertisements in the newspaper. Any real property liens, we need to get them out there. It's not something we do to embarrass anybody, but it's simply a statutory step we have to take. We have to publicly advertise that these are unpaid. We split our advertisements between the Times News and the Alamance News. So with your approval, we would like to run those with a $5 fee. We've been using the $5 fee for several years. That seems to roughly compensate us for the cost of advertisement. That way the citizens that are paying timely aren't picking up the tab for the ones that we have to advertise. So what I'm seeking this morning is a motion that any delinquent accounts be advertised with a $5 fee applied.
Okay. I have a quick question. What kind of response do you get from these ads? Like, of all the outstanding taxes, mm-hmm. what percent do you end up collecting as a result?
It's hard to be exact with that, because a lot of folks will pay in advance to avoid the ad altogether. When we send out a notice at the beginning of February letting folks know there's past due taxes and that it will be advertised if it gets into March, we get a very strong response. You saw the movement from 4.6 million to 2.6 million. How much of that are folks that didn't know and were reminded by the red letter? How much of that were folks that said, well, I better pay this before my name's in the paper? That motivation is hard for me to tell. I do believe that the knowledge that it will become public encourages some folks who pay in February every year.
But now that we're where we are today and we put that ad in, you expect a lot of collections as a result of the ad?
There will be some, but I think that most of the ones that would pay because of the ad have already paid in advance of the ad to stay out of the paper. Just to be honest.
And when is the date of the publication?
March 17th.
17th. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Indeed.
Just so that somebody might pick up and put that in the paper.
Indeed.
Before
and
it gets there.
We are running the file tomorrow morning, because you have to have the file produced in advance so that they have time to get it in.
Mm-hmm.
And so if they can get the money by 5 o'clock, by the time we close tonight, we can keep them out of the paper.
Okay.
Tomorrow's kind of a roll of the dice. Maybe yes, maybe no. So.
Okay. Any further questions or comments?
Mr. Chairman, if I could, and I should have talked to Jeremy before this, we hired a delinquent tax administrator in this year's budget. Do you see that as part of
absolutely.
The reason why our numbers are
absolutely
so much up?
Well, and that's the thing is, they, for a large degree, cover their own costs. if you look at the fact that they bring in fees for their work to offset the income. And then you also look at the boost of the collection rate. I think that it's been well worth it, and I want to thank this board for providing me with that. I think that it serves us well.
Right. Have you got any records of what that rate was last year?
As far as the...
As of today? Last year?
Well, I mean, absolutely. The question is, referring to the fees,
I mean, the
or
collection,
to the
percentage, rate.
At this
percentage
point, last
rate,
sure.
From this last year to this
year? Last year, as of March 2nd, was 95.7 something. I'd have to look it up, but I can get that versus the 96.
So we have, and it's paying to
definitely
have somebody
absolutely
working on this.
Yeah,
okay.
It makes a difference. And we have folks tell us on a routine basis, they say, well, we didn't know that you enforced anything because we've been running late every year.
That was natural.
Yeah, it's normal, right? But as we're becoming more and more effective, what I really believe is happening too is that when someone goes through enforcement, and we try to treat them as well as possible, they're still citizens even if they haven't paid their taxes. Mm-hmm. But when they realize that we will come and get the money, I think some of those become timely taxpayers. They prevent enforcement. And that lets our folks take another step forward and another step forward,
right,
because folks that they were chasing down last year have paid on time this year.
And I think DMV collecting on vehicles,
wonderful,
has just been a great
wonderful.
In fact, they like, I mean, they people, I, and when I go get a tag or something, they say, mm-hmm, oh, you got to pay your tax. Oh, that's good. I don't,
yes,
have to go to Graham.
Yes, we love it. And if I can have just a moment while I'm here in front of you, anytime that I get the opportunity, I will be remiss not to mention the reval. Mm-hmm. We have finished our data collection. The door-to-door activities that have been going on are now complete. So we're very excited about that. We probably have another couple of months of data entry, getting all that into the computer system. And we're about to press the button probably in a week, 2 weeks, to begin to bring some of this live and begin to see live data for the 2017.
And if I could make one more comment about,
yes,
that reval, mm-hmm, we spoke with the Farm Bureau group, and they suggested that we get out and tell the community about what's happened, but
yes,
instead of hitting them with it next January and they don't understand why,
exactly,
the tax bill is what it is.
We've been considering doing a series of town hall style meetings. Really, I would love to get the feedback in advance.
Yeah.
You know, once you put the job into place, it is done, and then you get the feedback, you might be surprised. I want to hear it first while there's still a chance to do,
right,
something about it.
And answer questions. I think that's
absolutely
a big part, is having knowledge of what's going on.
Yes,
all right,
definitely.
All right, so the motion will be, thank you, the motion will be that we to allow the tax administrator to go ahead and advertise all tax liens plus a $5 fee. And to begin collecting on delinquent accounts.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you,
Jeremy.
Next, we have fiscal guidelines. Ms. Roberts. Well.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
One of the Finances Department's performance goals this year was to look through our fiscal policies to see if there was anything that needed to be updated, anything that needed to be changed. And one item under Section 3.1 deals with our unassigned fund balance. There had been talk among the commissioners to have that set at a higher rate than the 20%. So I bring that before you this morning for discussion. We've heard in the past to have an unassigned fund balance of around 25%. We are currently at 20.16%, which is ultimately $26.2 million. By moving that target to a 25% unassigned fund balance would move us more in the neighborhood based on fiscal year 15 expenses to $32.6 million. That just continues to increase the strength of the county, that we are able to do one-time funding in projects and still maintain our financial stability.
All right.
So, can I ask you a couple?
Yes, please.
This policy that's before us, has this been a policy for some time?
It has been in existence for several years, yes, sir.
Several years.
Mm-hmm.
Just with different rates.
Right. Well, I'm in favor of, well, let me ask this question. The the benchmark for, or let's say the actual average or median or mean, however you want to express it, of the counties in our comparison group is what?
What the state does, they look at the LGC, they look at available fund balance, which for counties our size is around 26.29%. So if you're looking at available fund balance, that takes into account funds that the board has committed for further use, which for our category, we have anytime we have an economic development project that comes before, we go ahead and we commit those funds so that we know that they're available and they're not in the unassigned fund balance because it is a purpose for that. So currently for our total available fund balance, we are at 22.8%. So we're still slightly below the average of peer groups. The LGC is not putting as much emphasis on the peer groups as they have in the past because they know every community and every county has different goals that they're setting money aside in their budgets or setting money aside in their fund balance to do a one-time project. So what they're looking at more now are trends. And if they start seeing a county dip into those fund balances, their first question they're going to ask is that for a specific project that you had money setting aside for? Was it for a capital expense? Or are you just needing those funds for operational? It's not until they start seeing that steady trend that we're using fund balance for operational purposes that they're going to be raising a red flag. So every year when if we use fund balance, they'll say, what did you use that fund balance for? And if it comes into operational, then that's when they're going to raise the red flag.
So if we achieve the 25% in the unassigned mm-hmm. category, what will make our total available percentage?
I don't have that figure with me this morning, Commissioner Byrd, because that comes from anything that the board sets aside. Just like I know that there's an additional economic development request that Craig will present in a little while. When those funds are committed, that'll be added to the committed column. So that's based on the activity of the board, and that number changes every year because it's based on the prior year's expenditures. So when we go into our next budget season of 16-17, we'll have to look at our fiscal year 16 sure. figures to know what those percentages are. It's always a moving target.
I understand that, and you know, I've had people come up to me in the community saying that why is the county considering doing that as opposed to giving it back to the taxpayers? But, you know, at the hospital, it was pretty common. We expressed it in terms of days of cash on hand. And
exactly.
We would target like 150 days. So that's approaching like a 40 or 45%.
Right. 25% gives us 3 months, so one quarter.
Right. And then if you look at the actual policy number 3, where it starts off, it says the county will maintain the fund balance and retained earnings of the various operating funds at levels sufficient to protect the county's investment grade bond rating, which is I think is real important, to avoid cash flow interruptions, which is real important, to generate interest income, and to eliminate the need for short-term borrowing. So it really, I mean, I'm in favor of it because it really positions us to handle these contingencies as things change, and we do have a lot of, I mean, we don't have a good five-year capital plan yet, I don't think, but I just intuitively, I know that there are a lot of capital needs that we have with our buildings.
And one advantage of setting this policy is that, you know, we would strive to maintain that 25%, but as those capital needs come forward, then there are one-time expenditures. So we could utilize the increase in fund balance to fund those projects, and it doesn't overall or negatively impact our financial stability.
Now, one of the main purposes of doing this as well is this is going to drive the performance management
to up their
their
goals.
I mean, this is one of the primary maybe purpose, because really when we've had our discussions in the past about what our fund balance should be, it's been in the context of the performance management
plan.
And if I could also, it gives us the flexibility, you know, as we've talked about before, when the sheriff came and said that he needed a new roof,
right.
Instead of just patching, you know, and a roof being $10,000, you know, a new roof at the sheriff's department is $250,000.
Do it right. Yeah.
And, you know, instead of having to borrow money, instead of having to worry about our cash flow, instead of having to worry about things that we can't control, we had the cash on hand that we could assign. Some of the things we're going to do today in the budget, we're going to set aside money for ACTO. We're going to pay some bills for road improvements for LIDL. So it gives us that flexibility that we're not having to worry about how we go out and borrow money just to operate. And it does help us move forward. And again, the 25% is a goal that we have.
It gives us something to strive for.
Right. And it's a,
I think that's the key word. We're not saying it's got to be. Yeah, we're going to work towards.
Right. This is going to be a multi-year process to get to this point.
And it's a balance sheet kind of financial indicator about the organization's financial strength, which is really important if you do need to borrow money, because nobody wants to lend money to somebody who doesn't have money.
Well, when we were at below 8%, you know, years ago during the bottom of the recession, we didn't have the funding to buy ambulances. We didn't have the funding to put roofs on, and we were strapped for cash. And now that we have some flexibility, but the thing about county government, when you spend money at county government, you spend money at county government. It's not anything that is small that you usually spend money on.
And you don't gain more revenue because you spent money.
Exactly.
That's just the way that works.
What is the correlation between fund balance and bond ratings? Is there any correlation?
There is some correlation there. And about 4 months ago, we were contacted by Standard & Poor's, and they did a desk review. And that came back that our bond rating was staying the same at a AA-. And they gave me a report that said basically they could see that Alamance County was becoming a strong indicator again, that the economy was improving, the jobs in Alamance County were improving, and that with our fund balance being able to grow in the steps that it had, that they figured that in our next review or our next rating that we could possibly see that increased. Our rate increase.
How often do they do those ratings?
Basically, whenever we go for a bond sale, they're pretty mandatory to do those because we have to let
one of those coming up with ACC.
We do have one of those coming up because we have to let those people that we want to buy our bonds to let them know that we're in a good financial state, that we're not going to default on those bonds. And then periodically, about every 2 years or so, they'll do a desk review.
All right. Any further questions? Comments? Then I'll entertain a motion that approval for the changes in the Alamance County fiscal guidelines.
So moved.
Right. Second.
Right. Motion second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Appreciate it. Next, we have Memorandum of Understanding, ACTA. Mr. Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In front of you is an agreement between Alamance County and Alamance County Transportation Authority. One of the things that ACTA now can do is do urban trips. The negative thing about that is they can be reimbursed, but it's about a 9-month turnaround with respect for reimbursement. So they have to put out the money first. Then the federal government with $5,307 transportation dollars takes about 9 months for reimbursement. ACTA is not in the financial position to put up $350,000, so they've asked the county to serve as their bank for a short-term loan of 9 months at 0% interest with full repayment in September. So this is very similar to what we did on the natural gas conversion with ACTA. It was $150,000 that we fronted them. But we would, they would submit a request to us, and then we would do that up to $320,000 and $319 would be the max that we would front them. But again, we should have everything back as far as cash, that amount, anything we have front them by September.
Question?
Well, I would add that I'm serving as the appointee from the Board of Commissioners on that board, and we look at that very closely. In fact, I'm the secretary treasurer, so I'm looking at those
so
financial
you're looking at the dollars, aren't you?
I will say that ACTA is working very hard at improving its financial position by building up a reserve. It's made a lot of progress in the last couple of years. It's true that the way most of the funding comes to ACTA is that you provide a trip and then you apply for grant money. The grant's already been approved, but you can't draw it down until after you've already provided the service to the people. And they have a lot of different rules from these different grantors. about the timing of when you can even apply. You can't do multiple months at a time. I mean, it's really
a lot of restrictions.
Really puts the agency in a cash flow predicament. And now that we're not allowed to use some of these state grants for urban trips like we've done in the past, and we're going to this 5307 federal grant, it does put additional cash flow challenges to the agency. So.
All right. Any further comments? I'll entertain a motion this time that we do provide the temporary funding to be reimbursed. Funding amount says stated $320,919 to ACTA.
One thing, Mr. County Attorney, Mr. Albright, just to make sure that there's not a conflict of interest with me voting on this matter, since I'm on that board as well as this one.
As long as there's nothing going in your pocket.
Nothing's going in my pocket.
You're not giving you free rides.
All right, so I'll entertain that.
I'll make a motion that we approve this.
I'll second that motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
No.
All right, they do have one no. My understanding is that this is just we're fronting the money and we will receive every penny back that the grant has been approved. All right, thank you. All right, next we have performance management spending request. Brian Haygood.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I'm here this morning with two performance management program related items. This first one is a request that will require approval from the board. I'm asking that the board approves spending a total of $125,666.60 from the performance management savings balance for requests from the Health Department and the Parks Department. The Health Department has requested to be able to spend $25,666.60 for several items. This all information is all in your packet. This includes some software training for their new electronic medical records program. It also includes funding for staff to attend a national conference. There's funding in their request also for strategic plan efforts for their upcoming accreditation process. And there's funding also being requested by the Health Department to make improvements to the trauma care waiting room. Their total request, again, is $25,666.60. Parks Department is requesting to be able to spend $100,000 to do improvements to property at Sea Rock Park that is slated to become a new equestrian recreation area. These funds, if you'll remember, a while back, the department had asked for them to be able to be used as a match for a PARTF grant. So the department was planning to spend these $100,000 to make these improvements. Went after a PARTF grant. The grant was not funded, so they're asking to be able to do their part that they had said they would do. This includes establishing a parking area in the new property for equestrian horse and trailer use, also to install restrooms and to prepare a camping area for the folks that are bringing their horses to Cedar Rock. County Management and the Finance Department have reviewed all of these requests, found them to be in compliance with the approved policy set by the board, but it does take, these are all over $5,000, each of these requests. It does take approval from the Board of Commissioners. So I'll be happy to try to answer any questions you have. We also have the departments here, department heads here this morning. So,
any questions? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion at this time.
I so move we approve the expenditures.
For approval of both of these expenditures, I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
All right, motion second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
No.
All right, thank you. All right. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Brian, you're still up.
Yes.
Performance management goals, mid-year update.
Yes, sir. What you have, you also have a report in your packet that is a update for where the departments are in the performance management program for fiscal year 15-16. There's no action needed. This is simply a report to give you an update. This report that you've been presented speaks to the goal-setting part of performance management. It's got two parts. One part is they try to save as much money as they can to be able to use on some of these type projects, which we retain a portion of those savings. The other part is setting goals, which I think Ms. Roberts just mentioned that one of Finance's goals was to review fiscal policy. So, that helped helped her come this morning and bring you the proposal that she brought. Well, this report is part of our effort to keep this program transparent. And also to give you and the public an idea of what are the 24 participating county departments doing with the $58 million that you give them. You budget approximately $58 million county tax dollars for these departments to run. So that we hope that this will give you an idea of what they're doing with the funding that you're giving them. They've set across the board 179 total goals. This is not everything the departments do. It's a pretty good indication of their core services, but it's not every single thing that they do. And this report gives you an update of the status of all of their goals as of January 1st, 2015. And what we try to do is break them down into three categories: goals that have been completed, goals that are on track, look like they will be completed or still have the possibility to be completed, and goals that either will not be met or don't appear to be able to be met. We do allow departments to adjust goals in the first quarter. So if they set a goal or an objective and they start running into troubles, they have the first quarter to come to county management. We have a committee made up of county manager, myself, Susan Roberts of finance, Sherry Hook of personnel, and Andrea Rollins of finance also. And we review their requests to change. So we take it very seriously if a department wants to change a goal. And we've had, as you can see throughout the report, we've had four goals that have been adjusted this year. Two of them I'm going to speak on for just a moment, because I think it's very important that you know this. Two were from CECOM, from our 911 communication center, and they had to do with the amount of time it takes our telecommunicators to determine your location when you call 911 on your cell phone. And it was eye-opening to me how long it takes our folks to figure out where people are when you call 911 on your cell phone. I think Dexter indicated to me 75% to 80% of our calls to 911 today are coming from cell phones. They're no longer landline based. And it takes our folks a long time to figure out where people are. Because as you can well imagine, they are calling at a moment when they don't know where they're at, or they're in a panic, or somebody's hurt, or something's going on. And we hope that we'll be able to do some public education. I think folks in the county need to understand when you call 911 on your cell phone, you really need to have as good an idea as you can of where you are. I don't mean to get off on a tangent about it, but for CECOM to set this goal, then attempt to implement it, brought this out, that it is a real difficult process to do. And this is based on cell phone technology. There's not a whole lot CECOM can do about it. We are researching some applications that can be installed on phones that may help address this by sharing your GPS location data with CECOM as opposed to your cell phone. But anyway, it was a good product of a goal that they established. But we did have to adjust that goal. And we've also had some goals for, the report is incorrect, it's after we released the report to county departments, got feedback, went back through it. There are four goals that are struggling and appear that they will not be met. A couple of these were from Department of Social Services and also from Ag Extension Office. And we have talked with those department heads, and we know what's going on, and they're aware of their struggling goals also. As you look through the report, besides the goal information, you'll also see workload measurements. These are not goals. These are basically just reports of numbers. How many calls CECOM gets every month. How many people apply for food stamps at the Department of Social Services every month. It's a good, gives us a good idea of what their workload is. For the first time this year, we are looking at those workload measurements in a number of departments. As you look through that report, if you see them highlighted in yellow, that means that they are being compared to goals set by various cities around the state of North Carolina that are taking part in a project through the UNC School of Government, a benchmarking project. There is not one of those available for counties. We're comparing ourselves to city data. So no action required here. We want you to know where the program is at. We want the public to know this. After this meeting, this report will be posted on the county's website, so interested public can take a look. And I'll be happy to try to field any questions.
I have a couple.
Yes, sir.
You know, you said that, and the report says this is the status as of January 1st, 2015. You mean 2016?
Yes, indeed, 2016.
And just one other question. On the ones that are highlighted in yellow, will we have available to us how we compare to those other municipalities that are tracking this data too?
We will, but we won't have how we fell out until the end of the year. The School of Government is working with those cities, and we're not technically a part of that project, but we have requested their reports. So once we get their report, I'll be happy to prepare something for the board that'll say, here's where these department goals fell out compared to the cities.
What's the reasoning that they can't compare to county to county?
We just recently had Mr. David Ammons of the School of Government come in. He did a training for our department heads, because right now they're in budget time. This is the optimum time for departments to set new goals for 16-17. So we had Mr. Ammons came in, did a great class, And I was talking to him a little bit after the class, and he said at one time there were counties that were measuring goals, but for some reason the interest in reporting them as a group just fell off, and I don't know why. I think sometimes cities may have goals that they can track a little bit easier. Now they do a lot of street. When you look at the goals in the benchmarking project, there are a lot of public works related goals, and we do have facilities maintenance, but we're not doing quite as much streetscapes and water and sewer utility measurements. So
right. And as Brian also said, counties sometimes very difficult because, and thank goodness, the sheriff has been very good about reporting goals, but when you have elected officials and sometimes you have separate boards or social services or health, it's very difficult. We have a great social services and health department who provide those goals and provide those measurements and really are on board for this, but a lot of counties, it's very difficult to gather the information, but Brian's done a wonderful job, and Susan.
Well, our elected officials and appointees are all on board. Every department's participating. I think one thing that I will say makes this as effective as it is that it is tied to the savings piece, and a part of the savings piece is allowing the departments to give employee bonuses. That really gets folks' attention. They want to participate, and they keep up with their goals very well, because the board has recently changed the policy where you have to have success in 75% of your goals to be eligible to give those bonuses. So that's a very private business model, in my opinion. So.
Well, with respect to comparative data, we're still going down a track of enrolling in this program that you and I saw at the NACO conference last summer in Charlotte.
Yes.
That's put out by your professional organization.
Right. The ICMA, the program's called?
It's called Insights.
Insights.
That's right.
So we input our data, and then this organization has municipalities and counties all over the country inputting their data, and then we can run comparative reports to see how we stack up against some other benchmarks.
And I'll be coming to the board, in May with a final report from fiscal year 14-15 that will give you how everybody did on their goals, how many dollars were saved, and at that time I'm going to request that the board approve. It's going to cost about $6,000 for us to enroll in this software. I would ask that the board consider at that time approving that $6,000 to come off the top of the departmental savings, right? So the departments on average, I think, have been saving between $1 million and $1.2 million. So we'd ask that before anybody gets any allocations, we take that $6,000 off the top to purchase this software that'll help compare all the departments. That's right.
Yes. I think it would be a good investment to spend that just out general funds. Right. I mean, it's just something that's good management practice to do.
Yeah, I kind of like Brian's idea.
I do too. We take it off the top.
All right. Any further comments or questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Next, we have the Lidl assignment of agreement, Mr. Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On May 29th, the city of Graham, Mebane, and the county, we all approved an agreement with Lidl that is for the incentives for the new distribution center over at the North Carolina Commerce Park. They've asked that they reassign that. It was with Lidl US LLC, and now they've asked to reassign that agreement to Lidl US Operations LLC. Everything else, as far as the agreement, remains intact. It's just really assigning
different names.
Yes, sir. Yeah. And so this is the same assignment that will be approved by Graham and Mebane as well.
All right.
But everything else remains in full force and effect. Yes,
exactly,
sir.
What we had previously.
Yes, sir.
So.
Okay, I will entertain a motion if there's no comments that we change the agreement to the name Lidl U.S. Operations LLC.
Motion to approve.
All right. I'll second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. Next, we have the NCCP Oversight Committee recommendations. Senator Ralph Scott Parkway Road Improvements. Mr. Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And again, going back to the North Carolina Commerce Park, I serve on kind of the advisory board for that for the county, and one of the recommendations that we have is that we spend approximately $200,000, and those funds would go for the landscaping and improvements and some curb and guttering at the entrance to the park. This was part of what we had some agreements with some property owners that we would do. We have already given funding to the chamber of $100,000 for, you know, expenses at the North Carolina Commerce Park. However, before we make major expenditures, it does need board approval and buy-in. So our part of the work will be $66,667. But again, that is a third, and Mebane and Graham will pay the same amount. But again, the funds have already been given to the Chambers Foundation. We did that last year, and we will be using those funds for this expenditure.
All right, questions?
Can we have them come do a report on that project in the future, near future? Is that
I can have that at the next meeting.
You know, kind of update us on what's going on out there. What about the big pile of dirt? That's been a big issue, I know. Where they cut the roads and
that I don't know. We still have to pay. We will the final road bill for that extension. We've not gotten yet. You know, there was a lot of DOT money. There was a lot of foundation money. There was a lot of Golden Leaf money. There was a lot of different pots of money, and right. We still have an outstanding payment we'll have to make on that as well. That'll be upwards of $300,000. But again, in the long term, we've had a discussion that Samet has gotten some property under contract or under an agreement, you know, that they'll begin looking at site selection and certified sites from the state. So they may be looking at putting a shell building out there as well, because we're running out of inventory in Alamance County as far as really
That's a wonderful thing,
industrial building. Yeah. So. But this is, again, funds that we will take from the chamber that will be approved.
Okay, that's the only thing. I think I need an update on kind of know what's going on.
I'll have you an update at the next meeting.
Thank you. Any further questions? Not at this time. I'll entertain a motion that we authorize the use of the funding that's been pre-appropriated for this project, which is the enhancement of the NCCP entrance with curb guttering and landscaping.
Second.
All right, I have a second.
Second.
All right, a motion second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Moving on to number eight, item number 8-1 on our agenda, which is budget amendment, economic and fiscal development.
I will take that one as well. Again, this is some of the soft costs that we have, or Graham has incurred for the design and some of the initial costs for the road. Our part right now is $105,000, and that is a third of what has been expended to this point. So again, this is for the North Carolina Commerce Park Road, and this is part of economic development.
So why is this amount different than what we just approved?
Separate projects. The one that we just approved is for some landscaping, curb and gutter, basically to meet some of the agreements when we received the right-of-way. Some of the things that were promised in the right-of-way agreement were some curb and guttering, some signage, some landscaping that we had to do up front. And
with
this
property
is,
owners?
Yes, sir. Agreement
with the property owners?
Yes,
there?
Sir. When the original easements were given, they asked for these things, and this is to meet the requirements of that ask, was the first one. This is to cover, the road project started with Walmart. They've been working on it for years. This is to cover those costs up to this point. So there's a lot of soft costs that have been paid to Allie Williams, Carmen, and King. For road work and design, and so this is paying our third on that.
Right. Any further questions? So with that being said, I entertain a motion that we spend the budget funds for the county's one-third share, which is $105,000, $105,011.03 per previous agreement to the City of Graham for road improvements. I'll make that motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
All right. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
It's good to have a good fund balance.
Yes.
I think I got that right, that motion right.
Sounded right.
Okay, good. Next we have Recreation and Parks budget amendment. Mr. Baker?
I am back before you this morning to request a budget amendment from the county's contingency fund to help us cover the costs of some materials that were stolen from our department last fall. It was in October. We had a break-in at Cedar Rock Park in the maintenance area. They stole what we've estimated a little over $10,000 worth of equipment from our maintenance area. That's that was the value at the time. It's not necessarily the replacement value, which is a little higher. So it was a lot of money, but it wasn't enough to be covered under the county's property insurance policy. The deductible was higher than that. So those funds weren't available for insurance, and we're seeking some funds to help us just replace some of those items. We have taken some steps to make sure that doesn't happen again. We've already installed some additional lighting, and we'll be installing some security measures this year if we have the funds in this fiscal year. If not, it'll be after July 1st. But in the meantime, the guys need to keep working, so we are hoping to replace some of those materials.
Any bad guys in jail for this yet?
Not yet.
Not yet.
Yeah, a lot of that stuff, I'm sure, is traceable. Pawn shops and the like usually will lead you to that stuff.
I think. Didn't you say they came in on four-wheelers and stuff? It's kind of backdoor
entrances. It was an odd method, but they apparently stole a four-wheeler from somewhere else, drove it to the gate, went in and walked in and got our gator and our bolt cutters, went and opened the front gate, and left in another vehicle entirely and ditched both of those vehicles in the woods. So I'm not sure. Don't know if it was a plan.
When did it happen?
October 13th.
Yeah. All right. Any further comments? Motion to allocate $10,000 to cover from the county's contingency fund to cover loss and theft for the Recreation and Parks Department.
Motion to approve.
Second. Have a motion second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Next we have budget amendment maintenance. Ms. Roberts.
Good morning again.
Good morning again.
What the budget amendment before you this morning is to allocate $15,000 from appropriated fund balance to cover the cost of energy for the Cornetto East Town location for January through June.
All right. Any comments or questions?
I move approval.
All right. I have a motion for approval. I have a second.
Second.
All right. I have a second. Vice Chair. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
You're welcome.
We
I'm up for the next one, so.
Yep. Okay. We have a team there, and I think we've started also. There's some equipment in there I think the health department is looking at as well that they left that hopefully we can repurpose over at the health department. So.
Scabbage.
Sounds good.
All right. Go ahead.
Okay. All right, and the next one before you is to budget $3,800 for a grant that we received from Cone Health to purchase CPR kits.
All right, $2,800.
It actually should be $3,800.
It's a typo. So that's a typo.
Yes, it's a typo.
And where will these be placed? What's the?
As far as I know, they will be placed throughout the community. It was to purchase 100 CPR kits for them to use on the trucks.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. I understand a lot of that equipment is really in bad shape.
I'm going to defer that to Brian.
Well, these particular CPR kits are for when the EMS folks do outreach. They're able to give these to kids or to families. They go to various health fairs and things like that. Now, I know we are looking at how we're in the future we're going to replace their heart monitors on the trucks.
Yeah.
Those are some pretty expensive units. And I think we're meeting later this month with representatives from the companies that make those to look at how we go about replacing them. They'll be high dollar though. Mm-hmm.
Any further comments or questions?
I do want to thank Michelle Zeiser, who's our occupational health nurse, for helping us get this grant as well.
All right.
I'll make a motion to approve $3,800.
Motion approval, the amendment to $3,800 for this endeavor. Do I have a second?
A second.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Okay, that concludes that portion of our budget. Next, we go to the county manager's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to ask Libby to give a quick update on our strategic planning process and where we're at and next steps. So I'm going to turn that over to Libby.
All right. Welcome, Libby.
Good morning.
Really quickly, we've had more than 13 forums so far. That includes some of the trainings we've had, but we use those to generate information as well. So we're going to count those as well. We got three more coming up. March 8th, we're going to be down in Eli Whitney. Raritan Club has put together a forum for us. That'll be at 6 p.m. at their community center. March 9th, we'll have one with the Health Collaborative, who put that together for themselves as well. Speaking of Impact Alamance, this is directly related to them as well. That one will be at 8 o'clock in the morning at their at the Burlington, what do they call it? It's not their community, it's their municipal center. And then on March 17th, we will be at St. Matthew's on Apple Street to have a community forum there as well, 6 p.m. They've put that one together themselves as well. So we're trying to get out into the community, and we've visited all kinds of places, probably talked to a few hundred people, been very busy with all of that. So I don't have a copy of the work plan to give to you at this moment, but if you look back at that, these are the community forums that we've been putting together. We were hoping to have them done a little bit earlier, but due to weather and just how many we've done, we've pushed that forward just a little bit. So next steps from here is we'll be pulling all the information that we've gotten from the forums together. Hopefully submitting a draft to you guys to look over. We need to regroup about the naming contest so that we can pick our winner, because they're anxious. So any community groups that want me to go back out and present our findings, we'll get to that kind of into April. We need to start thinking about a feedback retreat for the commissioners themselves about what information we found as well.
You didn't mention the realtor board you got on.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
on the 23rd,
which I think was good.
I'm sorry, we planned that last minute last week.
I went back to make sure I was not dreaming.
It's correct, and that'll be during the day as well. I think they're going to start about 9 o'clock.
Just off the top of your head, now you've been to 13 different locations in the county. What's the biggest interest or area of concern that say the top two or three that you're hearing from our citizens?
There are a few. Probably the biggest thing that comes to mind to me right now is everybody says we want to know what's going on. Yeah. They feel like they don't know what's going on. The second part is there's a lot of concern about development.
Okay.
Strategic growth, I think.
Yes.
I've heard a lot.
Yes, and making sure that we're ready for when that comes our way. A lot of people are encouraging us to work well with our neighbors as well. They're very concerned that they want to see that continue.
All right.
It's been some very positive comments, I think, that have come out of this, and things that you don't really think about, but like the trails and
people love
I think
them.
Everywhere we went to, that was one of the big things that people appreciate that's really under advertised or whatever, for lack of knowledge. A lot of people don't recognize that, and it's been some real positive comments about what we already have here. We just need to communicate it better, I guess is the right word.
Well, I've been to several of these, and Libby's done a fantastic job. I mean, this takes a lot of work putting these together, and they're all run very professionally, and I'm just thrilled about the quality of the comments. People are speaking up. It's interesting that when they first start off, a lot of people say, when they go around and introduce themselves, well, they're just there to listen. They don't want to contribute. But pretty soon, they're contributing and having some very good.
They actually have a lot to say when it's all over.
You've got to pull it out of them a little bit.
But I would agree. The themes that I've heard are protecting land.
Yeah.
And they're concerned about development and, mm-hmm. you know, just development taking over the open spaces that we have. And especially farmland. People are real concerned there. About farmers and making sure that the farmland continues on in this community. I've heard lots of comments about the importance of education. Mm-hmm.
And our folks have volunteered their time to be at these. And
that's right.
I mean, that's kudos.
It's impressive.
All of everybody.
Lots of department managers participating. Yeah.
That have come out on their own time to work to do
this.
Number of
people here who have been out to help.
You know, one thing about the naming contest, I think you've got how many entries, like 30 or 40, it looks
yes.
like, of people's ideas about what this plan ought to be called. Mm-hmm. And one thought was to have the commissioners maybe pick your top so many and let Libby tally those up, and then we can choose from the top ones that get, would y'all be willing to do
sure.
that?
Sounds good.
So maybe...
Send all
like
those out.
Okay. Send each of us that list that we can vote.
All right. Didn't know that.
Whatever.
Any further comments? Thank you, Libby. Ms. Honeycutt.
Just a couple other things. One of the things I did want to mention to you is about the timeline for our bonds for the ACC for the Advanced Applied Technology Center. So we got a lot of things that are coming up and a lot of things that we're going to be asking the board to do, and just kind of wanted to give you a heads up. What we will be doing at our March 21st meeting, we will be asking you to pass a resolution that basically says we will reimburse the county for expenditures probably up to $2.5 million until the bond is sold. ACC at this point has been using some of their fund balance to fund some of the engineering costs, some of the architectural costs, waiting for the bonds to be sold. So what will happen is they're ready to start. Dr. Gatewood is chomping at the bit. So we're needing to pass a continuing resolution that basically says we will front them $2.5 million or at this point, and we will get reimbursed again once the bonds are sold. So we will ask you to do that at the 21st meeting, and also we will ask you to look at approving a resolution for a not to exceed for $15 million. So we're starting the process, we're getting close. They should have construction package out for bid in April. Then we would look at selling the bonds on May 24th and closing on June 24th. 14th. Oh, 14th, I'm sorry. I can't even read. So, and then at that point, they will begin construction, and they're looking to make sure that they're in by the fall of 2017.
And the first payment on the bond debt?
Maybe next year.
Yes. Our first interest payment would come due in February, and so we would have our first principal payment the following February in 2018.
What are we looking at? $1.2
million? Gordon Johnson with the LGC is getting that information to me today, so we'll have that for you at the next meeting.
Sounds good. Thank you.
But I did want to, one of the big things I did want the board to realize, we're moving forward. I appreciate Dr. Gatewood. I appreciate the work Susan's done on this. She's had some long meetings with Gundowers, our bond attorney, making sure that we get this thing on track and that we're moving forward and that the right things need to occur when they need to occur. So, again, appreciate Cindy Colling with ACC and just really been a good team effort working with the community college.
Any other comments?
And one other thing I do want to talk about, just to mention for our next meeting, to please bring your calendars. It's budget time. So budgets were due from department heads to finance at the end of February, which was February 29th. Most of our outside agencies are in. We have a couple of stragglers. Some of it is because we're waiting for final numbers from the state especially for social services and the health department for reimbursements. But we're going to compile that, and then we'll be ready to go and looking at sometime in April. So it usually, the last couple of years, is a 5 half-day event. We could do 3 1 week and 2 the next week in the afternoons to accommodate.
Thank you.
Commissioner Vice Chairman Basel. And but again, we will have departments make presentations, and also our outside agencies make presentations as well, very similar to what we've done. And I think that process has worked very well.
Thank you, sir.
If the board does have time, we do have a video from the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. It's about a 5-minute video if you want to see their monthly update.
I think we're fine today. We'll save that for another day.
We'll save that.
Thank you.
We'll close.
Hopefully.
Can we watch that on our own? Can we?
Yeah, we continue to link.
We'll watch it.
Okay. We'll
save
glad.
Some folks. Get our folks back to work.
I'll get you some popcorn next time.
We'll be glad. All right, commissioners' comments. Thank you.
Go ahead, Bob.
Well, you started. Well, I wanted to talk about the Stepping Up initiative. Because we have, thanks to Susan's hard work, you know, Susan and I are co-chairing this Stepping Up Task Force to reduce the number of people with severe mental illness in our jail. This is part of a national effort sponsored by the National Association of Counties, backed by the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, and the American Psychiatric Association's Foundation, and some other folks there too. But part of this initiative is to attend a summit, a national summit. And Susan, how many initiatives are there across the country? Like 100 or 200?
More than
100
now.
More? Yeah.
I think when we started, there were 90.
So this summit was, you had to agree to attend this summit if you could, if there were room. But it turned out that you had to apply for it, and it was very competitive. But Susan applied on behalf of our initiative, and we got accepted. So I don't know if this has to be approved by the commissioners, because the I don't know who's paying for it, if it's NACO or somebody else is paying for the travel and the lodging and the registration and all.
Yeah.
So
I don't think it would have to be approved.
The money's not even flowing through the county's books.
No, that's correct. The Psychiatric Foundation and a couple of private.
But we now have 4 subcommittees that are working on this, because if you think of all the opportunities there are, what we call diversion strategies and what's the word? You have a continuum of intercepts where from when a person first acts out and does something bad, and law enforcement is called to the arrest, to the setting of bail, to once they're in the jail and getting ready for discharge, what are you going to do to keep recidivism down? So we have 4 subcommittees, and one is the assessment and screening subcommittee, which is a matter of figuring out when a person is incarcerated, if that person has any mental illness going on, what are we measuring, so what should we track, and how can we tell if we're making a difference with this initiative. That subcommittee is being chaired by Chief Deputy Sheriff Tim Britt. Then we have the community service capacity, because key to keeping people out of the jail is what kind of mental health services are there in the community. So we need to inventory those. We need to identify what kind of gaps that we have, what kind of barriers we have, including financial barriers or political barriers, and trying to deal with those. And that committee is chaired by Robin Huffman, who's the executive director of the North Carolina Psychiatric Association. And then we have the Law Enforcement and Diversion Strategies Committee. So that's dealing with how can law enforcement be trained in crisis intervention techniques, and what can they do to help identify people who are not really being criminal, even though their behaviors might suggest otherwise. But that's that committee is being chaired by Elon's Chief of Police, Cliff Parker. And then we have the Reentry Strategies Committee. So that's dealing with, once somebody is incarcerated, what kind of assessments can we do, and identify what their needs are, so that when they are released, back into the community, those arrangements can be made with community resources to help keep them from getting back into jail. So that's headed up by Phil Bowers, who's the director of Sustainable Alamance. Phil's also doing GED classes in the jail as an agent of ACC. So that's kind of where we are. And I just wanted to mention, thanks Susan for the great work that she's done. And we all owe Susan some congratulations for getting us to be accepted into this conference coming up.
Very good.
That's all. Thank you.
Any other commissioners have comments?
I just want to report. I went down and took a tour of Dr. Gatewood, and they're getting back in some of their buildings that got burned. Their automotive and welding part are open, and he's excited about things going on there. I've never seen anybody get so excited about what's happening as he is. And actually, I talked to a couple of the training officers there for law enforcement. They put a bug in my ear, and the sheriff might know that they're down there advocating for something he's been working on. So, but great chance to go and see the facilities. A lot of good things are happening.
Any others? I'll be very brief. The sheriff, I had the opportunity, it's been a while since I had toured the jail facility, and last week I had the opportunity, the sheriff took me through. And let me tell you something, folks, that's a tough job those jailers have, but they have some very professional staff over there. And that place, to be a jail, was clean as a pin, and you know, that means a lot. So sheriff, your folks and you are doing an outstanding job, and we certainly appreciate that. I mean, it just very professional. Even the kitchen was immaculate. We had you can see those trustees in there cooking, and he's got a good lady looking after that now. And so, we're blessed in this county with that.
We are. Yes,
sir. Any other comments for folks? All right. Meeting adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.